let me start. I don't know. I'm trying to think sort of which order do I really want to go in. But let me start with the last paper, just because I guess it's fresh in people's minds. So the way I want to characterize it, I mean, Yesha highlights a very, very important point, meaning, namely, that banks are increasingly owned by asset managers. And we need to think through the implications of this. And I think that's absolutely correct. Now, what are the problems that she identifies? She identifies two. One is what I'll call the discipline problem, that asset managers are by nature passive investors, and yet we're counting on shareholders to exercise some discipline on banks and prevent them from taking the risks that got them into trouble in 2008. If we can't count on the shareholders to exercise some discipline on the banks, how are we really going to get this discipline? Well, you can rely on regulation, but we saw also before 2008 the regulation failed. So if you're moving away from, say, concentrated shareholders or people who actually have an interest in how the bank performs to passive investors, you're moving away from discipline on the banks, and that's going in the wrong direction. The second problem that she identifies is what I want to call the bailout problem, which is that one of the ways in which regulators have hoped that banks will be more careful is that the creditors of the bank will be bailed in. That is to say, will suffer consequences if the banks get into trouble. Now, personally, I'm extremely skeptical of this theory. We see the problem. We saw a huge problem in Spain when they tried to bail in some of the depositors. We're seeing a huge problem now in Italy, where the banks are in trouble, and the government is caught because the European Union won't let the government subsidize any bailouts, and yet the government is petrified in asking the creditors to take a hit. So I don't know whether this theory works at all, but Yesha's point is absolutely valid, that it's surely not going to work when you're talking about jeopardizing life savings of people. The whole notion of bail-ins is that you can separate out the creditors into depositors who are protected and other people who are knowingly taking risks. But if these other people really include people who have saved through the asset managers for their retirement, it's really hard to distinguish them from depositors. So we're sort of moving in the wrong direction on one and getting into trouble on the other, and it's not clear how we're going to find our way out. Now, but I'm not sure in the end where we go with this, you see, because there seems to be some implication in the paper that somehow asking that we got into this trouble because we asked banks to accumulate more capital. But clearly, telling banks that they can hold less capital is not going to solve the problem at all. Why? Because that will break down the firewall between the banks and the rest of the economy. What the paper says is that the firewall between the banks and the rest of the economy is illusory because the shareholders are asset managers. But that's not actually quite right. There is a firewall, and it is it is bank capital. The issue is more, is the capital going to be allowed a hit, or are we going to be continuing to bail out banks? It's really the second problem that I mentioned here. Now, so notice that if you reduce the bank capital, you increase the risk of a bailout right there. So that can't be the solution. The other possible solution is to say, no, we don't want asset managers, we want concentrated shareholders. But then you get into the problem of who are these concentrated shareholders, and do you really want, in any case, concentrated shareholders dictating the allocation of capital in the economy? The most blatant example being industrial houses owning banks, so they can treat them as piggy banks, right? Do we really want this? And also to go back to the firewall example, if you have a large company that owns a bank, and the bank goes under, that large company is going to go under, and in that sense, the firewall will be illusory. The only way to create a firewall is, as I said, to have as much capital as possible. So yes, we put the finger on an important problem, Yesha has put a finger on an important problem, but I'm really not sure what the policy implications are. And I want to carry that theme over when I talk about the other paper. On mis-selling. Now, I think this is a really, really important paper, and I sincerely hope that a lot of people pay attention. First, the paper demonstrates conclusively that there's a lot of mis-selling going on of financial products in India. And the most shocking example of this is some guy who goes into a bank, he asks for a specific product, ELSS, and they start steering him away from this product. That's pretty shocking, and for no rational basis. The other point that this paper makes is that disclosures, there's supposed to be a disclosure policy, but it's clearly not being implemented. When you go into a bank and you act in an ignorant way, very little gets disclosed to you about the financial products. And when you press them with questions, they start talking, but the information they give you is wrong. Right? So we have a serious mis-selling problem, we have a serious disclosure problem, and that's amply demonstrated in the paper, and these are really, really important conclusions. The comments that I have on the paper is, again, what do we do with this information? Right? Now, the sort of temptation is to say somehow we've got to crack down on mis-selling, somehow we've got to force better disclosures. I'm not really clear whether this is going to work. And I want to just briefly, before I finish, talk about incentives here. The interpretation of what's... See, before we recommend a policy, we have to understand what's causing the problem in the first place, right? So the paper's analysis is that the incentives are wrong, that in public sector banks, they're just trying to raise deposits, so they always recommend fixed deposits. And in private sector banks, they're just trying to make money, so they sell the products with the highest commission. That's a possibility, but it's not proved in the paper. That part's not proved. And I think this is the area for future research that we need to do before we jump to any policy conclusion. And of course, the paper doesn't have policy conclusions, but we need to get to a policy because there's a serious problem, right? Now, let me give a completely different interpretation of what may be going on. What may be going on in the banks is that is something completely different, namely ignorance on the part of the people who are selling and ignorance on the part of the people who are buying. And you have this combination of uninformed sellers and uninformed buyers, and you're getting to a very bad equilibrium. And one of the reasons why I suspect is that, for example, with disclosure, it's not that the sales people were adverse to disclosing. When they're asked to disclose, they disclose. They just don't know the answers. And why don't they know the answers? Essentially because in order to learn the answers, they have to devote a considerable amount of time to research the products, which in some cases are quite complicated. And what's the incentive for them to do this? There is no incentive. Similarly, customers have very little incentive to learn about the products on their own. And until we sort of figure out how to give proper incentives on both sides, I'm very, very doubtful that we're going to get anywhere. So what I think is going on, and I'll just finish here, is that when you go to a public sector bank, they just take a call on what they're actually doing is protecting themselves. One of the things that I'd like to see in a sort of follow-up paper is an analysis of what happens in repeated games, where you go back to the bank. And what I think these bank officers are really trying to do is they're trying to stop complaints. So if you're sitting in a public sector bank, somebody comes in and he asks for an ELSS, you think immediately, oh my God, this is linked to the stock market. If the stock market goes down, this guy's going to come back to the bank and he's going to start complaining to me. If I sell him a fixed deposit, he will never, ever come back and complain. No, he may not make a real return when you take into account of inflation, but he's not going to get me into trouble with my branch manager. So this is what I'm going to recommend. I don't care what he says, because my only goal is to protect myself. And I think you need to sort of see what happens, for example, if people complain, and see what dynamic this generates, including whether it actually changes behavior at a bank. Just to sum up, I think both papers raise really, really important issues that we're going to need to start thinking about quite deeply. So I'm really, really grateful to all three of the authors. Thanks.
So I'd like to toss it open to the floor for any questions. I forget which order to. I looked at Mandar first, and then we'll take Michael. Anjali, you had a question? And sorry, I don't know your name. Hansi, right. So that's four. Have I missed anyone? Okay, sorry. David. So Mandar, would you like to? Can I ask all these the questioners? Ask one question at a time. I'll come back to you.
Absolutely. Only one. Yeah, so just to sort of push back against the theory, a quick summary would be that, you know, pools of capital have been held by mom-and-pop households, really, small households through these diversified mutual funds, and and therefore they underwrite the risk that banking sector takes, and that could sort of, you know, create political risk down the road when it comes to bailout and the like. But the question that I had, you know, going through that argument is, you know, wouldn't the capital market, so to speak, provide an adequate hedge? Is it a problem that's not solved by capital markets? Because if you follow the process of the way a bank deteriorates the capital position, we have the prompt corrective action regime, we have the stress tests that are public, we have the living wills now for systemically important banks that are public. So, you know, these guys, by virtue of their diversified positions and lack of concentrated interests, can easily exit the market at the slightest possible sign of trouble in favor of, say, the more sort of, you know, the people that are more aggressive, distressed debt investors come to mind quickly, like distressed asset investors come to mind quickly. So I'm just wondering if capital markets don't already adequately provide a hedge against this risk. That's it.
Mandar, that's an awesome question, and it's one that, you know, that I've been thinking about in looking at questions of run risk in relation to the asset managers themselves, and more broadly as to whether or not the diversification within these asset managers actually makes it harder, provides a natural hedge in this context. And so this your question connects very nicely within that larger field of inquiry. I think the question about whether or not the capital markets provides a hedge is really an interesting one, and one that's kind of speculative. So your theory is that basically the exit opportunity that the capital markets provide would be something that would safeguard the value that these pension funds and others are holding. I think that really rests on two assumptions. One, that the capital markets stay liquid at a time of banking and financial distress. And second of all, that the valuation within these portfolios is not lost by the fact of selling at a huge undervalue in the context of distress selling within the capital markets themselves. And I think, when we look back at the financial crisis, what was clear at that time was that capital markets themselves were very badly hit. This S&P 500, fell 40%, the value, at that point in time. And furthermore, the capital markets did not stay liquid. You know, they had to be revived in order to maintain their ongoing function. So just simply relying on the capital markets to remain liquid and for these institutions not to sell at a huge discount, because to get the hell out of these investments, I'm not sure that necessarily reduces the loss of value that they're likely to face in that context.
Michael?
I'm going to violate your rule, but I'll make two very quick comments, one for each of you. Both papers I thought were terrific and really helpful. Monica, the empirical work was just wonderful and consistent, unfortunately, with empirical work that's been done in many contexts, right? So mis-selling is horrible here. It's also horrible in the UK. It's horrible in the US. It's horrible in many countries around the world. And that gets to the question, is there some fundamental lesson? So when I think of the people who are selling financial products in most contexts, whether it's in India or the US or the UK, they could also be selling a pair of jeans or anything else. They're just salesmen. So I think that, you know, the idea that we're going to train our way out of this problem, I think, is not happening. And I agree, I associate myself with all of Josh's earlier remarks about the complexity of what's going on in people's minds. Most of the time, I think they think that they're selling somebody what they think is the right thing. It's just that they're wrong. So that leads me to think, and I think, you know, in terms of follow-up work, you know, are there techniques we can use to automate, to force transparency with crowdsourcing, to do other techniques that are taking the discretion of the gene salesman out of the picture. For Yesha, I think it makes sense to take a step back in your frame, which is already quite broad, and just think about the functions of finance. So the financial system just connects the household sector to the household sector. It's just a thing that either well or badly connects the household sector to itself. So there's no real question that at the end of the day, if the financial system is broken in some way, it will hurt the household sector, because that's all there is. So the question is, can you construct a financial system that is less likely to cause enormous harm to the household sector when harm is caused to the financial sector? And then you have to ask a whole series of more complicated questions about the nature of the claims that is held by the household sector in the financial sector. And can you allocate those claims in a way that makes it less likely to propagate risk? Not block risk, but less likely to propagate it. And I'd be happy to follow up after.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much.
I just respond very quickly. Also to something that Josh had also said, that we have uninformed sellers and uninformed buyers, and then we need to possibly make this better But I don't know if you can actually have informed buyers because of the complexity of the problem. So an average person needs 8 to 10 financial products. Each of them are offered by 20 to 25 companies. Each of the companies have 50 to 100 products with brochures. So the ask is too much of a person who's a doctor or lawyer or whatever else. So you will have to have some other third-party person putting out league tables, which is where the role of the regulators is important, because disclosures they've looked at from the point of view of saving their own sort of skins and said that you should disclose all material information. Now, what is material? I think regulators will have to work much harder to pin down what the disclosure is in what format and make it open so that third-party aggregators can use that and throw out league tables or star ratings or something so that average people can look at that and then take a decision, because we cannot read those brochures. And the point that you're making, that the person selling is making a call saying that this is the right product for you, I am not so certain. I mean, so now I'm going to fall back on anecdotal evidence. I think there is enough anecdotal evidence that they are maximizing, some of them are maximizing their incomes, their bonuses, their commissions. Also, the internal communication from banks that the other hat that I wear as a journalist that we get hold of, it is really about just that sale, no matter who you sell to.
Anjali? Yeah, so I think Monica has partly answered my question on especially the minimum information. So my question was that, you know, I can walk into a multi-brand car outlet, and there the seller is not telling me which car to buy, right? I'm an informed customer, I compare the features, I know the prices. And hence, is it that there is a third-party aggregator who can? So insurance, in some cases like car insurance, this has happened where third-party aggregators give you a lead table. Housing loan rates, this has happened. Clearly, there is need for some of these investment products to be made more transparent by third-party aggregators rather than. So fundamentally, the question was, is this minimum disclosure known to anyone, including the person selling? I think on a more philosophical level, the question to ask is there a cause for separating the role of the distributor and the advisor through a regulatory intervention? So it is that, you know, the standard disclaimer that this is not to be deemed as advice. When analysts write the report, they say this is not to be deemed as advice. And the question really is, in case of financial products, the guy is selling. He's not advising. He's just selling. And the question then is it just transparency and ensuring that this is not deemed as advice? And then, you know, it's buyer beware. But in this particular case, they are wearing the dual hat of advisor come distributor. And the question is, should that be disaggregated in some manner? It's not an easy answer to give. But, you know, the multi-brand car example holds pretty much. If you had minimum information, would you rely on the salesperson to pick the car that you wanted to buy? Clearly not.
You're not really shopping for the alloy of the wheel or the kind of carburetor or, you know, so the disclosure, the way that it is made now, puts too much of information and knowledge responsibility on the consumer. So again, the regulators need to rethink what they want people to disclose. A lot of that should be under the bonnet.
Hansi? Oh, sorry, Renuka. Right.
Hansi. Hi, can you hear me? Actually, partly Monica's already answered it, but I was just sort of picking up from you, Josh. Yesha, when you said the big asset managers are the BlackRock, State Street, and the Vanguards, interestingly, they're all passive managers. And even if they're not, an asset manager, an AMC, can only ever stay in mandate, whatever the investors have asked them to do. So either they're a passive manager or they're an active manager. If they're an active manager, they're influenced by the investment consultants and the rating houses. So in a way, partly they're affected by what the active consultants and rating houses are asking them to do, which leads also to, I guess, what Monica's already raised. There's no way today, anywhere in the world, a retail investor can pick a mutual fund and actually say, I know what I'm doing. Interestingly, all regulators say, in direct shares, here's all the information you need to know, and institutional and retail investors are treated equally. But in mutual funds, they only give you a product brochure, which basically is, says we invest in shares and we are wonderful, and here's past performance. And by the way, past performance is no guide to future performance, but you can pick a star rating, which basically is past performance. And increasingly, I've noticed regulators, because they can't handle qualitative research philosophically, they basically default back to star ratings. So on one hand, they say past performance doesn't work. On the other hand, we will pick funds that have a five-star rating, which is basically they performed well. So what I'm saying is a lot of these problems, both these problems, I think are related to the fact that there is not enough information being given to retail investors to allow them to pick mutual funds. And even the third-party rating houses are not doing a good enough job, partly because they are not getting paid enough. So at the moment, the system is broken somewhere where I think we're not asking the intermediaries to justify their recommendations. So when the bank manager says, here's this fund or here's this fund, they're not being asked, not by the regulator, not by the investor, not by the by anyone, to justify that recommendation. And I'm saying there's not enough information in the market for advisors certainly to do the research, and there's not enough rating houses. So just a food for thought, that part, a lot of these problems seem to be appearing from the fact that everyone has hundreds of books on stock investing, not a single good book or process on mutual fund investing, and people are just being asked, go and pick a mutual fund on brand and performance.
Thank you. Big problem.
Thank you so much.
Just a question.
I guess I wondered, whether these were the right investors to lose money because they're diversified holders of the whole stock market and so should be able to survive a dramatic decline in value of one or a few stocks. But secondly, I guess I wondered, I think this is a really good project, but I wondered how far you wanted to go down the line of the Posner Weil Michigan sort of institutional investors collude, because it's an inefficient way of making for a stable banking sector. But in theory, if a bunch of bank owners tell banks not to compete against each other and stay profitable, that's more likely to do the thing that usually bank regulators worry about the most, which is make the system safe and sound. It may not do much for the consumers of banks, but if that's the case, then maybe we should celebrate the institutional investorization of at least that one part of the economy. So I wonder what you thought about that.
Yeah, David, I think that's awesome, and thank you so much to Hansi as well for that comment. You know, I think that the question of the run risk is the $18 trillion question, right? And it's not one that I am entirely that I've, you know, done enough work on to be able to provide a definitive answer. As you know, as Hansi kind of alluded to, these guys are diversified, and particularly if they're passive index investors, all they're basically doing is following the stock market. So in that case, you know, they're not making active decisions to invest in banks. And you know, furthermore, given the fact that in the last quarter or so, banks have actually made incredible profits in the last quarter, that maybe it's justified that they should in fact be investing in the banking sector as part of this diversified portfolio. At the same time, what we do know at the financial as the financial crisis illustrated, is that you know banks are the failure of banks has an incredibly wide impact across a cross section of different other types of stock. So the stock market as a whole lost about 40% of its value across different types of industries and companies. So even the facts of diversification in these mutual funds and others may not necessarily protect from a more global hit that arises to the value of their portfolios because of the failure of critical credit providers and intermediaries in that system. You know, the question of the competition is I think is, you know, I mean, I'm not really looking at this from the competition angle, which is what Einar and others have been sort of looking at. But, you know, one thing that did become apparent during the crisis and that, you know, continues actually to be a problem is the correlation seeking within the banking sector and taking correlated risks across the system. And one thing that capital regulation has been criticized for just as a concept is that it doesn't deal with the system-wide risk in the market. It just deals with individual firm risk in the market. Certainly we have G-SIFI charges charges and others that deal with a more systemic impact. But at the same time, banks can engage in more correlated risk-seeking behavior, and that may be incentivized by the fact that these passive investors or others are just telling banks to do certain things similarly across the board, and that may in fact lead to a sort of crisis more broadly owing to sort of correlated bad behavior.
Thank you, everyone, for the comments. I want to respond to one of Josh's comment and then talk a little bit more about what policy conclusions can we draw. So one, Josh, you mentioned that it's possible that the bank managers didn't sell the ELSs because they just didn't want complaints. However, you know, when we sort of asked why did they not sell ELSs, many bank managers themselves didn't know about ELSs. So it seems that ignorance was more the reason than fear of selling a market-linked product. So I'm sure in certain instances what you said was right, but in many others it was that the public sector bank staff itself was quite ignorant. And then we come to the questions you asked, which is why is it they are ignorant and why is it that, what is the incentive for them to do better? And that's where I'll sort of, you know, pick on a policy conclusion that we haven't talked about so much, which is the issue of enforcement. So in India especially, it's not as, so, you know, violations will always be on a spectrum, right? So there are some that are hard to catch, but then there are others that are egregious. And at least on the egregious violations, we should have seen some enforcement by the four regulators that we have. And yet, you know, year after year, we see reports, Monica does a lot of work on, say, persistency of life insurance policies, and yet we just see no enforcement. So I think that even before we start worrying about what is distribution and what is advice, if we at least got some enforcement on the things that we know are really, really wrong, we will make some progress, and that will further incentivize managers to behave better, because, you know, there is a, it's not just about carrots, there is a stick as well, which is entirely missing. Finally, you know, there is, in the course of doing this paper, we realized there is a literature where you sort of ask, you know, questions around how do you regulate when you don't know what you don't know, right? And that seems to be the case with most of our investors. You know, when you walk in, you don't even know that there is a feature like a cost. So if I don't know that exists, I'm not going to ask questions. And so if I'm not going to ask questions, I'm not going to get a response to them. And I think that's the sort of field or where we want to start thinking about regulating this space. And that brings me to the question of product regulation, right? If advice is so hard, if fiduciary standards are so hard, and we are seeing evidence from the US again saying fiduciary evidence is only increasing further fees, sorry, fiduciary standards are only further increasing fees. So that's a difficult way to get into. Suitability is hard. Can we then go back and say, you know, should we just do product regulation so that we don't allow toxic products to be in the market at all? Because it seems that the more nuanced ways of regulation are just so much more difficult.
Is there any other question on board?
Follow up if you have the time. Otherwise,
no, we are out of time on that one, but I do want to ask Monica slash... No, we are out of time. Monica slash and slash Yesha, is there something that we want to... you want to respond to Josh's comments?
So my response would really be to say a big thank you to Josh. That's my response. And to thank you to all the commenters as well for your incredibly sort of cogent and insights on this paper. This is the beginning of a project, and it's a very early draft. And I'm so open to comments and to ideas, and so I really appreciate all that input. So thank you very much.
Monica? You may not be able to tell, but the force of nature is hungry, and lunch is just outside. But very important topic. We've debated this, and partly it's been triggered by the entire FSLRC debate on consumer protection, at least, and systemic risk, and how regulation and law needs to be able to deal with this in a cogent manner. And I think that it's the most difficult task, because unlike walking into a multi-car sales shop where you know what you want and you can test it on day one, financial products just don't show their performance until you're too old to deal with it, or you're really stressed and you need that money. So I think that's the tension. And I don't think it's a simple problem to solve. And it does require more aware investors, of course. Caveat emptor seems to be a great thing to sell in this space. But the challenge is there something that we can do in terms of a support? And one of the ideas was always Perhaps there needs to be, every fund manager must have plain vanilla products out first, right, which does not require a PhD to understand all the complexities. And over and above that, if they want to sell products, so be it. But for the plain vanilla products, it should be low cost, maybe even put a fee which is very close to zero, because you expect to get volumes out of that. And everything else, charge whatever you want, but it's caveat emptor. So that's a thought, and lovely field to be continuing to do research in, EM or DM, right? And that's a nice thing. Thank you.